Dear friends, I am Dr. K. Kannan, Professor Mechanical Engineering, Anjaliyammal Mahalingam Engineering College, Kovilvanni. I am happy to meet you again in the video lecture on the subject Fluid Mechanics and Machines. And this is lecture number 4.4. The topic, subject topic is Fluid Kinematics. In the previous lecture also we discussed the Fluid Kinematics. And this lecture, the topic we are going to discuss are steam function, flow net, forced vortex and free vortex flow. In the previous lecture in fluid kinematics, we discussed the velocity and acceleration, circulation and vorticity, velocity potential function. So, the mathematical expressions for velocity, acceleration, the condition for circulation, vorticity and the theorem, velocity potential function, the condition for velocity potential function and the use of the velocity potential function. And here in this lecture, at the end of the lecture, the learning outcome to the student, at the end of the lecture, the student will be able to explain this steam function and they will discuss the flow net, the concept of flow net, and they will define the free vortex flow and forced vortex flow in fluid mechanics. Steam function, like the velocity potential function, the next function is steam function, which is psi. Steam function psi is defined as a scalar function of space and time such that its partial derivative with respect to any direction gives the velocity component at right angle to this direction. So, the partial derivative, it gives the velocity in the right angle direction. So, mathematically, we have two equation expressions, mathematically for two dimensional unsteady flow, psi is a function of x, y and t. X, y are the spatial coordinate and t is the time. And for two dimensional steady flow, there are only spatial coordinates, there is no variation of the parameter with respect to time. So, psi is a function of x and y. Now, the steam function are for two dimensional flow in Cartesian coordinate, dou psi by dou y equal to minus u and dou psi by dou x equal to v. So, u is the velocity in the x direction. So, the derivative with respect to y direction, that gives velocity in the right angle direction, which is minus u, minus of velocity u. And derivative with respect to x direction, that gives the velocity in the right angle to this direction, which is v. So, this equation you have to remember. So, dou psi by dou y equal to minus u and dou psi by dou x equal to v. Now, similarly, the steam function for two dimensional flow in cylindrical coordinate system, dou psi by r into dou theta equal to minus v r and dou psi by dou r equal to v theta. Then comparing the velocity potential function, the steam function equations, we have this expression. So, earlier we defined dou phi by dou x equal to minus u and dou phi by dou y equal to minus v. Now, here we defined the dou psi by dou y equal to u and dou psi by dou x equal to v. So, comparing these two equations, the function relation between velocity potential and the steam function, dou phi by dou x equal to dou psi by dou y and minus of dou phi by dou y equal to dou psi by dou x. And these two equations are called as Cauchy-Riemann equation in Cartesian coordinate system. The relationship between velocity potential function and the steam function, that is called as Cauchy-Riemann equation for Cartesian coordinate system. And similarly, we may write the equation for cylindrical coordinates, the Cauchy-Riemann equation for cylindrical coordinate system, dou phi by dou r equal to dou psi by r dou theta and dou phi by r dou theta equal to minus of dou psi by dou r. And you have to remember the Cauchy-Riemann equation Cartesian cylindrical coordinate system. Sometimes they may ask a question, verify the Cauchy-Riemann equation. So, you have to find out dou phi by dou r, dou phi by dou theta, dou psi by dou theta and dou psi by dou r, and you have to substitute here and verify whether the condition is satisfied. Using this equation, the steam function may be determined if the velocity potential function is known and vice versa. Once you know the velocity potential function, we may calculate the steam function, or when the steam function is given, you can calculate the velocity potential function. Then the rotational component in the z direction. So, it is given omega z equal to 1 by 2 dou v by dou x minus dou u by dou y. Then substituting value of u and v from the steam function, omega z equal to 1 by 2 into dou by dou x of dou psi by dou x minus dou by dou y of minus dou psi by dou y. So, simplifying, this is 1 by 2, omega is equal to 1 by 2 dou square psi by dou x square plus dou square dy by dou square psi by dou y square. And this equation is called as Poisson equation. So, this is the final equation, omega z equal to 1 by 2 dou square psi by dou x square plus dou square by psi by dou y square. This is the Poisson equation for two-dimensional flow field. For irrotational flow, omega z equal to 0, then the equation becomes dou square psi by dou x square plus dou square psi by dou y square equal to 0. And this equation is called as Laplace equation for psi in two-dimensional plane. So, this is Poisson's equation. So, Poisson equation, right hand side we have some value in the Laplace equation, second order partial derivative equation, right side equal to 0. And when this condition, if the steam function satisfies the Laplace equation, then it is a possible case of steady, incompressible and irrotational flow. The same thing we concluded in the velocity potential function. When the velocity potential function satisfies the Laplace equation, then it is a possible for steady, incompressible and irrotational flow. The same thing is applicable here. When the steam function satisfies the Laplace equation, then it is a possible case of a steady, incompressible and irrotational flow. Substituting the steam function in two-dimensional continuity equation, dou by dou x of minus dou psi by dou y plus dou by dou y of dou psi by dou x equal to 0. So, finally, we conclude dou square psi by dou x dou y equal to dou square psi by dou y dou x. Next, we define the flow net. The line along which velocity potential function phi is constant is called as equipotential line. So, we define the velocity potential function phi. So, the line along with velocity potential, line which is drawn using the velocity potential function is called as equipotential line. For steady two-dimensional flow, phi is a function of x and y. So, d phi equal to dou phi by dou x dx plus dou phi by dou y dy. And the velocity potential function u equal to minus dou phi by dou x and v equal to minus dou phi by dou y. So, d phi, substituting the value of dou phi by dou x equal to u here and dou phi by dou y equal to v here. So, substituting the value here in the first equation, dou phi equal to d phi equal to minus u dx minus v dy. So, for equipotential line, d phi equal to 0. So, therefore, the slope of the equipotential line dy by dx equal to u by minus of u by v. So, the line which is drawn using the equipotential line, actually velocity potential function is called as equipotential line. So, when we draw the equipotential line, the slope of the line equal to dy by dx equal to minus of u by v. So, this you have to remember. So, remember, just a moment you remember. Then, the line of constant steam function, which is psi is constant. So, the line of constant steam function, where psi equal to constant for two-dimensional flow. So, psi is a function of x and y. So, d psi equal to dou psi by dou x dx plus dou psi by dou y dy. So, from the steam function, dou psi by dou y equal to minus u, dou psi by dou x equal to v. Substitute the two values here in the first equation. So, d psi equal to v dx minus u dy. Now, for constant steam function line, d psi equal to 0. So, therefore, the slope of constant steam function line dy by dx equal to v by u. So, earlier we calculated the slope of the equipotential line dy by dx equal to minus v by u, and here dy by dx equal to v by u. Now, it is clear that the product of equipotential line and steam function line at the point of intersection is equal to minus 1, right? So, thus equipotential line and the steam lines intersect each other orthogonally at all points of intersection. So the slope of the two lines, the product of the slope of the two lines equal to minus 1. So that means the equipotential line and the steam function line intersect each other orthogonally at all points of intersection. A grid obtained by drawing a series of equipotential line and a steam line is called as flow net. So the definition of the flow net, a grid obtained by drawing a series of equipotential line and a steam line is called as flow net, and the flow net is an important tool for studying the two-dimensional irrotational flow. Right? How the flow net will appear. So this is the flow net, x direction, x line, xy plane, and these are all equipotential lines. So phi equal to c1, phi equal to c2, constant velocity function lines, and the horizontal line, this inclined line, they are constant steam lines. So psi equal to c1, psi equal to c2, psi equal to c3, and these two lines will meet orthogonally. It is perpendicular. The angle is 90 degree. So the at all points, the equipotential line and the steam line, they meet at 90 degree. They meet orthogonally. And this mapping, this net, this is called as flow net. And this is the important tool for studying the fluid flow numerically. So in the numerical mathematics, so you have to form the grid. So based on the grid, you can find the velocity or pressure at any point within the flow field. So the some of the application of the flow net, so we will see here. Flow through a converging boundary. Suppose there is a nozzle like this. So we can draw the constant velocity potential function and constant steam function lines. So they meet perpendicular to each other, and we will get a grid. So this grid is called as flow net, and using the flow net we can find out the velocity at different points here using the numerical technique. And similarly, a diverging passage, a diffuser. Right, then we have a equipotential line, flow line, right, velocity potential. So it is a dam with a gap, and here you have a concrete dam with a wall. So for any fluid flow, whether this is fluid static or fluid kinematics or fluid dynamics, so for the flow through any conduit or machine, we can use this concept for determining the parameter, flow parameter, like pressure, fluid parameter, pressure, velocity of the flow field. So which is useful for studying the behavior of the fluid within the boundaries. So the use of the flow net are to determine the steam line and the equipotential lines. They are used to determine the velocity and the pressure distribution for given boundaries of the flow. So calculating velocity and the pressure in the fluid mechanics is very important for calculating the rest of the thing, the energy, force, everything we can calculate from pressure and velocity. To determine the design of outlet for their streamlined flow. So based on the parameter like velocity and pressure, so we can determine the outlet of the system. And the limitations of flow net are, the flow net analysis can be applied only for potential flow region, not for viscous flow. So there are two types of region in the fluid mechanics, fluid flow. One is potential flow and viscous flow. So we'll discuss later stage. So we'll discuss what is potential flow and what is viscous flow. So potential flow, it is more ideal. So it is irrotational flow. Viscous flow, the viscosity effect will be coming into picture. So which is very difficult to analyze. So the flow net analysis is applied only for the potential flow region. The flow net analysis cannot be applied in the region close to the boundary where the effect of viscosity is predominant. That is what I told. When the flow is viscous flow, where the viscosity, effect of viscosity is predominant, so the flow net concept cannot be applied. The flow net analysis does not give clear result in the downstream side of the solid body because of the flow separation and eddies. So you can look at here. So this diagram, there are found some circulation, eddies. So when you have eddies on the flow passage, then it is very difficult to predict the parameter here using the flow net concept. And these are all the limitations of the flow net. Then we define the vertex flow. So the vertex flow is defined as the flow of fluid along a curved path, or flow of a rotating mass of fluid is known as vertex flow. So when the fluid is flowing through a curved path or flowing about the rotating mass, then it is called as vertex flow. There are two types of vertex flow. One is forced vertex flow and free vertex flow. And forced vertex flow. The enforced vertex flow, some external torque is required to rotate the fluid mass. So the fluid mass rotate at a constant angular velocity omega in the forced vertex flow. The condition for forced vertex flow, the tangential velocity of the fluid particle is given by V by R equal to constant, where R is the radius of the fluid particle about the center of rotation and V is the tangential velocity. And examples of forced vertex flow, a vertical cylinder containing liquid which is rotated about its central axis and with a constant angular velocity. The flow of liquid inside the impeller of a centrifugal pump. The flow of water through a runner of a turbine. So, these are all the examples for forced vertex flow, where the force is given for the rotation of the fluid mass. So, this is the example for forced vertex flow. So, flow through the centrifugal pump impeller. This is the centrifugal pump impeller and is force flowing through a impulse turbine. So, these are all the example for forced vertex flow. And the free vertex flow, there is no external torque required to rotate the fluid. The fluid rotates due to the rotation imparted to the fluid previously. So, for a free vertex flow, V into R equal to constant, where R is the radius and V is the tangential velocity. The examples of free vertex flow of liquid through a hole provided at the bottom of the container. Flow of liquid around the circular bend in the pipeline, whirl in the river, flow between blades of axial flow turbo machines. So, this is what the free vertex flow. So, when the fluid is flowing through a river, there will be circulatory flow. The circulation flow, the fluid particle is rotating about the center, mass center. That is what the free vertex flow. And we will study, so in advanced fluid mechanics, you will be studying more detail about the free vertex flow and forced vertex flow. And this concept is very much useful in the design of the hydraulic machines. So, normally in the hydraulic machines, it is forced vertex flow and the impact of the forced vertex flow on the design of the impeller, particularly impeller of the hydraulic machines will be discussed in later stage. So, we stop here. So, these are all the books I published earlier in the mechanical engineering subject, design of transmission system, turbo machines, heat and mass transfer, operations research, gas dynamics and jet propulsion, thermal engineering, and you may find the fluid mechanics and machinery book. So, that will be useful for this subject. You can refer to it, and I have a YouTube channel where I upload the video lectures on the subject, and the solution for the gate question paper is also uploaded. So, it will be very much useful for the mechanical engineering students. So, you subscribe and use the videos for your better learning and to pass in the examination. So, thank you for watching. So, please post your comments on the comments box. So, you subscribe the channel so that you will get the updated video. So, you can contact me through my mail ID or WhatsApp number for any further clarification. We will meet again in the next video with other topic in the fluid mechanics.